Gulshan, subject data communication and computer network. Myself, Prakash Meena, assistant professor, computer science and engineering department, Indian College, Ajmer. So today's topic is related to shortest path algorithm and flooding. So last we will study flooding, then start with shortest path algorithm. So begin our study of routing algorithm with a simple technique for computing optimal path key, given a complete picture of the network, and this path are the ones that we want to want a distributed routing algorithm to find, even though not all routers may know all of the details of the network. So the idea is to build a graph of the network with each node of the graph representing a router and each edge of the graph representing a communication line or link. So to choose a route between a given pair of routers, the algorithm just finds the shortest path between them on the graph. So concept of a shortest path we can explain here. One way of measuring path length is the number of hops. Using this matrix, the path ABC and ABE, you can see in here picture, the first six step used in computing the shortest path from A to D. So for using this matrix, the path ABC and ABE in figure are equally long. So you can see here ABE and ABC. Then another metric is the geographic distance in kilometers, in which case ABC is clearly much longer than ABE. Okay. So you can see in picture also. Then many other matrices besides hops and physical distance are also possible. For example, each edge could be labeled with the mean delay of a standard test packet as measured by hourly runs, and with this graph labeling, the shortest path is the fastest path rather than the path with the fewest edges or kilometers. And in general case, the labels on the edge could be computed as a function of the distance, bandwidth, average traffic, communication cost, measured delay and other factors. And by changing the weighting function, the algorithm would then compute the shortest path measured according to any of a number of criteria or to a combination of criteria. So several algorithms for computing the shortest path between two nodes of a graph are known, and this there is one of the Disastras and algorithm, and finds the shortest path between a source and all destination in the networks. So each node in Disastra, each node is labeled with its distance from the source code along the best known path, and distance must be non-negative, as they will be if they are based on real quantities like bandwidth and delay. And initially no paths are known, so all nodes are labeled with infinity, and as the algorithm proceeds and paths are found, the labels may change, reflecting better paths, and a label may be either tentative or permanent, and initially all labels are tentative. When it is discovered that a label represents the shortest possible path from the source to that node, it is made permanent and never changed thereafter. At last of our discussion in shortest path, I will show you an online animation for shortest path algorithm, Disastra's algorithm. So we will study about more for shortest path. So there is a question, how the labeling algorithm works. So look at the weighted undirected graph of figure 5.7a. So where the weights represents, for example, distance. So we want to find the shortest path from A to D, and we start out by making nodes A as a permanent and indicated by a filled in circle. So then we examine, in our example, each of the nodes adjacent to A relabeling each one with distance to A. Whenever node is relabeled, we also label it with the nodes from which the probes were made so that we can reconstruct the final path later. And if the network had more than one shortest path from A to D and we wanted to find all of them, we would need to remember all of the probe nodes that could reach a node with the same distance. And having examined each of the nodes adjacent to A, we examine all the tentative labeled nodes in the whole graph and make the one with the smallest label permanent, as shown in figure 5.7b. So this one becomes the new working node. So we now start at B and examine all nodes adjacent to it. And if the sum of the labels on B and the distance from B to the node being considered is less than the label on this, that node, we have a shortest path. So the node is relabeled. And after all the nodes adjacent to the working node have been inspected and the tentative labels changed, if possible, the entire graph is searched for a tentatively labeled node with the smallest value. And this node is made permanent and becomes the working node for the next round. And here you can see all the first six steps of algorithm in here figure. So why the algorithm works at the point we have just made E permanent, and suppose that there were a shortest path than ABE, say EXYZE. For some x and y, there are two possibilities: either node z has already been made permanent or it has not been. If it has, then e has already been probed, so the exyze path has not escaped our attention, so thus cannot be a shortest path. So consider again an example where z is still tentatively labeled. If the label at z is greater than or equal to that at E, then AXYZE cannot be a shortest path than ABE. And if the label is less than that of E, then Z and not E will become permanent first, allowing E to be probed from Z. And so the algorithm here given for Dijkstra's algorithm to compute the shortest path through a graph. And the global variable n, here the global variable n distance describe the graph and are initialized before shortest path is called. And the only difference between the program and algorithm, compute the shortest path starting at the terminal node T rather than at the source node S. So you can see here one of this n variable and list variable. So I think okay. So here is variable, there are dist maximum nodes and maximum nodes. Okay, distance ij is the distance from I to j. Since the shortest path from T to S in an undirected graph are the same as the shortest path from S to T, it does not matter at which end we begin. And the reason for searching backward is that each node is labeled with its predecessor rather than its successor. And when the final path is copied into the output variable path, and the path is thus reversed, and the two reversal effects cancel and the answer is produced in the correct order. So here we completed a shortest path algorithm. Now we will see online animation. So you can also check for Dijkstra shortest path online animation on Google search. So here you can see that there is a vertex, known cost and path, and then there is a directed graph, and you can choose undirected graph, small graph, large graph, and you can get the logical representation, adjacent list representation, and adjacency matrix representation. So here we only use directed graph, undirected, and other options are same. So here our vertex we will take just like 7, then run it. So So for 7 it's running, you can see here. So our result is here. Okay, now for undirected, and again we will run for 7. So run this cluster. So here you can see how the graph is working. An algorithm is completing the shortest path for as per this cluster shortest path. So now for logical representation, the output is given here. Now the nodes are calculated the distance to get the shortest path. Okay, you can use various animation for this. So that's all for discussed the shortest path here. Then our next topic is flooding. So let's start with flooding. When a routing algorithm is implemented, each router must make decision based on local knowledge, not the complete picture of the network. A simple local technique is flooding, in which every incoming packet is sent out on every outgoing line except the one it arrived on, and flooding obviously generates vast number of duplicate packets. So in fact, an infinite number, unless some measures are taken to dump the process, and one such measure is to have a hop counter contained in the header of each packet that is decremented at each hop, with the packet being discarded when the counter reaches zero. And ideally the hop counter should be initialized to the length of the path from source to destination. And if the sender does not know how long the path is, it can initialize the counter to the worst case, namely the full diameter of the network. And again, flooding with a hop counter can produce an exponential number of duplicate packets. As the hop count grows and routers duplicate packets they have been before. And a better technique for damming the flood is to have routers keep track of which packets have been flooded, and to avoid sending them out a second time. One way to achieve this goal is to have the source router put a sequence number in each packet it receives from its host, and each router then needs a list per source router telling which sequence number originating at that source have already been seen. And if an incoming packet is on the list, it is not flooded. And to prevent the list from growing without bound, each list should be augmented by a counter k, meaning that all sequence numbers through k have been seen. And when a packet comes in, it is easy to check if the packet has already been flooded. And the full list below k is not needed, and since k effectively summarized it. So flooding is again, flooding is not practical for sending most packets, but it does not have some important issues. Flooding is not practical for sending most packets, but it does have some important uses. First, it ensures that a packet is delivered to every node in the network, and this may be wasteful if there is a single destination that needs the packets, but it is effective for broadcasting information. And in wireless, for example, all messages transmitted by a station can be received by all other stations within its radio range. And you can say it's flooding, and some algorithms utilize this property. Then another, flooding is tremendously robust. Even if a large number of routers are blown to bits, flooding will find a path if one exists to get a packet to its destination. And flooding also requires little in the way of setup. The router only need to know their neighbors. This means that flooding can be used as a building block for other routing algorithms that are more efficient but need more in the way of setup. And flooding can also be used as a metric against which other routing algorithms can be compared. And flooding always chooses the shortest path because it chooses every possible path path in parallel and no other algorithm can produce a shorter delay. So now the flooding is over here. So our session is also ended here, and we will go for more routing algorithms in next video. So thank you.